64. Chewing gum, chocolate, small packs of crackers, granola bars, and et cetera. So anything that will benefit them, I'm sure they'd appreciate it very much. Then as far as those who are cleaning the church this month, the month of February, is Fonda and Nellie Johnson, and we thank you for that. There's also, if you don't know, there's a covered dish meal today to welcome me and Susan, which I've already told church they've done more than enough already. So just as soon as the service is over today, we'll walk right next door over to the fellowship hall, and I hope that everybody can stay with us and join in, and appreciate everybody for everything that you've cooked and everything that you brought as well. There is going to be a New Market Civic Ham and Egg Supper. It will be Saturday on February the 24th from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. at the New Market Community Building. If you don't know where that's at, you can ask just about anybody and they can tell you it's right up the road. The youth ministry will be meeting on February the 25th, and that is from 5:30 p.m. until 7:30 in the fellowship hall. There will be a country breakfast here on Saturday, March the 16th from 7 a.m. until 10 a.m. in the fellowship hall. There also will be an Easter egg hunt on Saturday, March the 23rd at 1 p.m. until 3 p.m. in the fellowship hall and the church grounds. The ages are 18 and under, and they do need donations, just as small toys, stickers, et cetera, things like that, they'll fit in the eggs, and also other gifts and toys that won't fit in the eggs. So there's a list of examples back here on the bulletin board right behind me. Then the Easter sunrise service. We hope all of you can attend. It will be on March the 31st, and it will be at 6:30 a.m. That's why it's called a sunrise service, so you can see the sun rising, okay? Then there will be a benediction in the cemetery afterwards. Sunday school classes will be immediately after then. Sunday school assembly in the sanctuary. And breakfast will be in the fellowship hall after Sunday school assembly in the sanctuary. And there will also be a regular service at 10:30 a.m. That same morning. So it will be a very busy morning on sunrise service as far as that goes. We do hope you can attend, and I'm sure that you'll enjoy each and every one of them, okay? As far as our prayer requests, I'm supposed to hold this thing. If you look up on the screen, you'll see all the names and everything. We have added a couple this morning. We have added Ricky's brother. His name is Craig Frazier. And also we added someone that Cheryl helps take care of and mention this morning. We just call him Slim. So we've added these two outside of everybody else. But is there anybody else we need to add to our prayer request list this morning? Anybody anywhere at all as far as names?
Robert,
yes.
Guy Cousins Memorial is going to be at 6 o'clock Thursday at Mount Union Church in Trinity.
Okay, do pray for this family. And, of course, as always, pray for the families of all those that's lost loved ones in the last week or so. We don't always say it. Of course, we need to continue to pray for Israel, pray for Ukraine, all the innocent families, the hostages, the battle, even our own soldiers were being killed over there. So we just need to be praying on behalf of all of that, and I'm sure you already are. Is there anything else this morning as far as prayer requests?
Robert, you can take Susan Jester on. She passed away this week.
Oh, I'm sorry, ma'am.
And you can remember grandson of Caleb. He has got the flu. He's been so sick.
All right, we remember Caleb this morning.
My mom is already on the prayer list, but she's been fighting pneumonia for about a week now, so if y'all could just remember her.
And her name?
Tanya.
Tanya, okay.
And Tuesday, we found out my dad has a early stage dementia, so.
Oh, I'm sorry. What's his name, Taylor?
Danny.
Danny. Do pray for Danny. We have dealt with that. We know all about it, and we will be praying.
Sure. Thank you.
Anybody else this morning? I know we've got a busy day. We usually have special singing, and but we asked Seth that he would just sing a couple choir songs this morning. So when it's time for the choir to come up, you come on up, and we'll sing a couple songs then as far as that goes. We've got a busy day. We're just trying to save a little bit of time because I do won't have time for the message this morning as far as that goes. We don't want to cut that short. But if there's not anything else, we'll go to the Lord in prayer, unless there is. All right. Let's all pray this morning. Our Heavenly Father, as always, we thank you for the opportunity and privilege we have to be in your house this morning. We thank you already for the Sunday school that we've had. We thank you for the good attendance, the faithfulness of each and every member, as well as the visitors that may be here today. And God, we do pray, and our heart does go out to each and every one that's on our prayer request list this morning. Those that are suffering, Father, through pains of the lost loved one, and those that God suffering physically this morning, that your touch, your healing hand may be upon them. And then, Father, we pray as well for the spiritual need of each and every one today. Those that are here, those that will be listening and watching the YouTube as well, and God, we're thankful for all the listeners that we have. But we just pray that this service, as well as all service, will always uplift the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because without him, God, we wouldn't have this opportunity. We wouldn't have this privilege. And God, we just pray that each and everything would be to glorify him this day. Bless all that's said and done, and as always, we'll give you the glory and the praise. For it is in Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. The reading of the Psalms this morning, that's going to be Susan Wilson.
The mighty one, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Our God comes and does not keep silence. Before him is a devouring fire and a mighty tempest all around him.
He calls the heavens above to the earth that he may judge his people.
Gather to me my faithful ones who made a covenant with me by sacrifice.
The heavens declare his righteousness, for God himself is judge of them all.
Thank you, Miss Susan. I appreciate it very much. So we'll go ahead and go to the encouragement song, I guess, as far as that goes. And then the choir, if you would, come up just for the time's sake this morning. Make your way up.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? Cause shame's done all it's stealing. And you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Who can wipe away the tears from broken dreams and wasted years? Until the past to disappear. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus. In all the wrong turns that you would, going on to if you could. Who can work it all for your good? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about
Bye.
all fellowship if you would this morning. Yes.
Dustin's piano playing. My mother loved to hear Dustin play the piano.
Amen.
And this morning I could feel her.
Amen. Yep. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a good hand clap. Amen.
Center on page 514. Page 514. For the singing this morning, it was very good. Choir always sounds good as far as that goes. If you would look with us at the screen up here and follow along with us, if you would, as we read the Apostles' Creed, the statement of our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and Jesus Christ,
his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried.
The third day he rose
from the dead, he ascended into heaven, sitteth at the right hand of God,
Father Almighty.
From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead.
I believe in the
Holy Spirit, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. All right.
Good morning, everyone. How are you guys? You doing good? It's fine. Okay. So I'm looking forward to us spending time together eating today. So, but first we want to ask if there's any birthdays to celebrate today. I know there's one.
Papa.
Yeah. I'm sorry? Oh, wonderful. So we got Ricky and your granddaughter. You guys want to sing happy birthday? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. And do we have any anniversaries to celebrate today?
Yes.
No, we do? All right. Well, I know we have a holiday and it's coming up, and it's February the 14th. Do you guys know what that holiday is? Yes, Valentine's Day. That's right. So today we're going to talk about the Greek word for love. The Greek word for, we're going to talk about agape love. So here it is. It's agape. If you could spell it out, it's A-G-A-P-E. And agape love is the highest form of love. And so you can't measure God's love, because the only way you can measure it is by the cross, because he sent his son so that the world could have eternal life. So it's an action. It's not just a word that you say. So I'd like to say, like, you go to a party and you have a bunch of cupcakes, and one of them is like mashed up, and you have a friend you want to give a cupcake to. So which one are you going to give your friend? Are you going to give them the mashed up one or the not so good mashed up one?
I do.
Huh? You do? You're going to do that? Well, of course you want to give them the best. So that's Christian love. Just showing, you know, because love never fails. Paul said in 1 Corinthians, out of faith, hope, and love, that love is the greatest. So the love that you have for God that you show others, you make that decision to do that. So this is the God by love that's deep down in your heart, the godly love, agape love. It pleases God. So maybe you can remember this word agape, because Jesus loves all of us so much, and share this agape love that you have with all the people around you. And I don't want you just to do that on Valentine's Day by handing out cards and stuff. I'd like for you to do that every day. Show Jesus's love. I know. I'm so thankful. I know. Okay, so it's agape love. It's the greatest love of all. All right. So I guess we'll get our prayer fingers ready. Get our prayer fingers ready and pray. Okay. Thank you, Jesus, for this day. Thank you, Lord, for all your many blessings. Thank you for the agape love that we have down in our hearts because of you, Lord. It only comes through you and by you. And we just praise you for this day. Bless the children and their families and all our loved ones, Lord, as we go about our day here today. And bless the sermon today, Lord, and may it touch all of our hearts, and may we show agape love every day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So I got a special treat for Valentine's. Here you go. There you go. Happy Valentine's Day. Happy Valentine's Day. Here you go, Colin. Happy Valentine's. You're welcome. You're welcome. Hi, Paisley. Happy Valentine's, honey. Oh, that's a not so good one. Here, take this one. That one's messed up. Here, here's a better one.
Well, I do appreciate all the little children. I appreciate my wife taking time to do the lesson each and every Sunday morning, as far as that goes. If you would look with us one more time up at the screen and read with us the Lord's Prayer.
It says, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. All right. If you have your Bible with you, look with us this morning. Over in the book of Genesis, chapter number 25. I'd appreciate that. The book of Genesis, chapter number 25 this morning. For all of those that were here last Sunday or maybe have watched the YouTube channel, we had a lot of trouble with our microphones, and I apologize for that. Brother Jeffrey has been working on it real hard all week long, trying to get everything working. And then, of course, the computer went down the first thing this morning, so that didn't help a whole lot. But hopefully he's got everything worked out right now, okay? I do want to wish everyone a very early but yet a very happy Valentine's Day coming up this Wednesday. I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful week. And I do want to kind of speak to you or bring a message just real shortly this morning as far as what a great love story is in the Bible, as far as I'm concerned, one of the greatest love stories. Some of it I'm just going to walk you through, and I won't read all the scripture that I wish I could this morning for time's sake. But over in chapter number 25 is where we want to start. And let's have a word of prayer just before we get started in the message. Our Heavenly Father, again, thank you for those who are here. Thank you for those who God had a desire to be present and be faithful to your house this day. We thank you for all these little kids, and we do pray that you look after them, keep them safe, help them, God, for all the days of their life. We thank you, God, for each and every name that's on our prayer request list. Once again, we pray for your healing and the needs thereof, that each and every need might be met. We pray, dear God, thou would help us, lead us, and guide us, God, this week that's coming, that, God, as my wife just said, we might show the agape love that you've shown to us. And God, we thank you for the opportunity and privilege to try to bring the message this morning. I pray, Father, Lord, that you open our hearts, our eyes, and our ears this day. Help us to receive that God you have in store for us. And I pray for all those who are listening as well. If there be one anywhere that don't know you and the forgiveness of sin, that God, this would be the very day they'd realize that need of salvation. For it is in Jesus' name we pray and ask these things. Amen and amen. All right. As I said, I want to kind of walk you through or walk you into the message this morning as far as that goes. And in the book of Genesis chapter number 25, it talks about the birth of two twin brothers. Their names were Esau and Jacob. Now, you can find this. I'm not going to read all of them. But you can find this starting in verse number 19, chapter number 25. And it goes all the way down to verse number 25 as well, or verse number 26. Now, this is a story, and I'm going to talk as quick as I can. This is a story about a man named Isaac who had a wife whose name was Rebekah. And at 40 years of old, Isaac prayed unto the Lord and asked the Lord to bless Rebekah with children, because she was barren. She was not able to have children. And you'll find out that the Lord did bless and touch and help Rebecca and Isaac to have two twin boys. Again, their names were Esau and Jacob. And the Lord even knows that Rebecca came to him one time and asked the Lord a question, why there was so much struggle within her womb. Because it said in verse number 22, I think it is, that as they struggled within her, even little bitty babies, they were struggling. She couldn't figure out why. And the Lord gave her an answer and said this unto her, it's because there are two different nations within you. And you'll go on to find out a little bit more that the first one that was born, his name was Esau. And the Bible says he came out red and hairy all over. And then the second one, of course, born was Jacob. And the Bible says that Jacob actually even had his hand on the heel of Esau when he was born, because there was a struggle between which one was going to come out first. Because they may not know it as little babies, but the father knowed, as well as the laws as far as Israel's concerned, was the first one to come out was to get the blessing. The first one that was born was to be the one that the younger served. But yet the Bible says here in chapter number 25 that there's going to be a difference, because the Lord even told Rebekah that in this particular case, even though Esau came out first and then Jacob, that the younger would actually serve, or the older, excuse me, would actually serve the younger. There was always a struggle between Esau and Jacob and their life. And I have to lead up unto the message this morning. You'll even also find out that not only was there a struggle between them, okay, and also there was a struggle for Jacob. He wanted to be born first. It just didn't work out that way. It was God's plan that the younger would be the one, or the older would be the one to serve the younger in the end. Now, the Bible says that Esau was a man that despised his life. Esau was a great hunter, or was a hunter. I don't know how great he was of a hunter. And the Bible says in chapter 26, verse 34 and 35, the Bible says Esau was 40 years old when he took to wife Judith, and also he took another wife, Bathsheba. And the Bible says that these two women were a grief unto Isaac and Rebekah. Now, the reason why, because Esau was a man who made a lot of wrong decisions for his life. Even as a hunter that he was, the Bible says that Esau came in one day from hunting, okay, that he had took no venison at all, and his father Isaac loved the venison, the deer, if you don't know what that is. He loved the deer that Esau had went out and killed every day and fixed for him. But on this one particular day back in 25, chapter 25, and you can read all this. I encourage you to read all of this. This great, great, great message and just great love story leading all the way up to it. That Esau came in, he was hungry. And the Bible says that he actually gave up, or he actually sold his birthright to Jacob, his younger brother, just for a bowl of pottage, because he was hungry. So that's why I say I don't know how great of a hunter he was either, because he came back empty-handed. So as Esau began to go on and make more decisions, wrong decisions in his life, there was also another story that comes to mind right before we get into the message, is that Isaac realized he was getting ready to pass on. At least he thought he was. He was getting older. And once the king, or that man in charge, the father is in charge, as he was seeing his eyes dim, he was losing his vision, and he knew life would not last much longer, he was supposed to hand down the blessing to the oldest son and let him be in charge of the household. And the Bible teaches us, now that's all I want to talk about Esau right now, but the Bible says also in chapter number 27 that as Isaac had called his son Esau, he said, "Esau, I realize that I'm getting old, my eyes are getting dim, but I would like to have some of your venison stew." So he sent Isaac, or he sent Esau out to the fields with his bow and quiver and whatever weapons he's had. And while he was gone, Rebekah heard the conversation in between Isaac and Esau. And the Bible says that Esau was Isaac's favorite son. But the Bible also says that Rebekah had a favorite, which was Jacob. Even though I'm sure they both loved both sons as far as that goes, it turns out that Esau was supposed to receive the blessing. And as Isaac had sent him out to the field and Rebekah had heard the conversation, she went to Jacob and she said, "Jacob, we need to do this." Now, I already read to you or told you that Esau came out a very hairy man. And, of course, Jacob was not. He was just a plain man, simple man, normal man like most men are nowadays. So Rebekah went to Jacob and said, "We need to do this. Your father is getting ready to give Esau the blessing." So she was just as much to blame as Jacob was as well. She said, "We're going to fix venison stew, and we're going to put the hairy coats and lambs or whatever it might be, furs that Esau had gone out and killed of the goats and things earlier, on your skin and around your neck. Because since Isaac was losing his vision, of course, the only way he could tell it was his son was to lay hands on him and fill him. So therefore, Rebekah said she would deceive her own husband. And Jacob was right there in the middle of it, because Jacob was going to get the blessing because Esau had done sold him his birthright. So everybody up with me this morning, right? Everybody's good, okay? So what we find here, even though Esau had married two different women, like I say, they were not the women that Isaac and Rebekah wanted him to pick out, but in other words, he made his choice, and his choice was something he would have to live with. So what happened next is Esau became to hate Jacob very, very much. And Esau wanted to kill Jacob, and you can find all that in the scripture as well as far as that goes. So in chapter number 28 it was, you'll find out in verse number 1 and verse number 2, I'll read this. Bible says, "So Isaac called Jacob after he'd already blessed him, gave him the blessing. He charged him and said unto him, Thou shalt not take a wife of the daughters of Canaan. Arise, go to Padan-Aram, to the house of Bethuel, thy mother's father, and take thee a wife from thence of the daughters of Laban, thy brother's wife, thy mother's wife." And then now in verse number 7 says, "And that Jacob obeyed his father and his mother and was gone to Padan-Aram." So Jacob took a journey because his father, Isaac and Rebekah, said, "We don't want you here around Esau, because Esau has threatened to kill you and murder you and take his rightful blessing." So Jacob, being the obedient son that he was, he took off to a state or a different town called Padan-Aram, if that's how you pronounce it. And as he went there, they already had told him, Isaac and Rebekah, they'd already told him, "We want you to go down there. We want you to visit your uncle, whose name is Laban. And we want you to take of a wife of Laban's daughters." Now, if you ain't figured that out, it would have been his cousin as far as that goes. But what takes place, and this is where we want to start reading this morning, is chapter number 29, if you look with me. Bible says in chapter number 29, "So then Jacob went on his journey, and he came into a land of the people of the east, and he looked, and behold, a well was in the field, and lo, there were three flocks of sheep lying by it, for out of that well they watered the flocks, and the great stone was upon the well's mouth." So as Jacob did go on his journey, the first thing he came to was a field. And the Bible says, "At this field there were several people there with several different herds of sheep and goats and things like that to water them." And then if you look with me down verse number 5 and 6, the Bible says, "And he said unto them," talking to the gentleman around the well, he says, "Do ye know, or know ye Laban, the son of Nahor?" And they said, "We know him." And Jacob said unto them, "Is he well?" And they said, "He is well. And behold, Rachel, his daughter, cometh with the sheep." Now, verse number 9, Bible says this, "And while he yet spake with them, Rachel came with her father's sheep, for she kept them. And it came to pass that when Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of Laban, his mother's brother, and the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother, that Jacob went near, he rolled a stone from the well's mouth and watered the flock of Laban, his mother's brother. And Jacob kissed Rachel and lifted up his voice and wept. And Jacob told Rachel that he was her father's brother," other words, kinsman, "and that he was Rebekah's son. And she ran and told her father. And it came to pass that when Laban heard the tidings of Jacob, his sister's son, that he ran to meet him and embraced him and kissed him and brought him to his house. And he told Laban all these things. And Laban said unto him, surely thou art my bone and my flesh. And he abode with him the space of a month. Now again, just to catch you up, this actually is his mama's brother. Laban would have been his uncle. And the Bible says just as soon as he seen Rachel in verse number 11 there, he kissed her. Now, I don't know that that means he went and kissed her on the lips. If anything, I think he probably gave her a kiss or a peck on the cheek. And then the Bible says when Laban found out that his nephew was there, he went and kissed him as well. Now, let me say this to you, okay, kind of jokingly in a way this morning. The Bible says we're supposed to give the right hand of fellowship to all of our brothers and sisters. And I do know that there are some in here because of germs and because of COVID, things like that. You don't shake hands, and that's fine. I understand that. But what are you going to do when I start kissing you on the cheek? That's the only thing I want to know. Okay? Just think about that. But then the next thing that takes place is verse 15 is where our story actually begins. We know that Jacob had already done seen Rachel. We know also that Laban had invited Jacob to come and spend a month with him. So in verse number 15, if you'll look there, the Bible says, so and Laban said unto Jacob, because thou art my brother, shouldest thou therefore serve me for naught? Tell me, what shall thy wages be? And Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. The Bible says Leah was tender-eyed. In other words, she was easy on the eye. The Bible says, but Rachel was beautiful and well-favored. And Jacob loved Rachel and said, I will serve thee 7 years for Rachel, thy younger daughter. And Laban said, it is better that I give her to thee than I should give her to another man, so abide with me. So they worked out this deal that Jacob would work for him for the next 7 years for the hand of marriage of Rachel because he loved her. Verse 20 says, and Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed unto him but just a few days for the love that he had to her. Now, let me make this comment. We'll read on to verse number 21. I know there's probably some of you been serving the Lord longer than I have. But this coming April will be 39 years that the good Lord saved my wandering soul. And I will say in 39 years, it seems like it was just yesterday. These 39 years have gone very quick for me because the same reason why it went quick for Jacob. Jacob found something or somebody that he loved. And he agreed to work for 7 years for the love of his life. But yet, even though it was 7 years, he said it only seemed like a few days. I've been serving the Lord by his grace now, and always by his grace, for almost 39 years. And I realize that it's just been a short time. And I am looking forward to many, many more years if the coming of the Lord doesn't come very quick. But I'd like to issue this with you as well. The reason why it seems like a very short time is because I found something or someone that I love dearly, and that would be God. In fact, I even told my wife many a times, when I am dead and gone, this is what I want on my tombstone. I first used to say he loved God, but then I got to thinking about that. My love's not going to stop when they lower me in that grave. My love is going to be stronger for God then than it ever has. So I told her, I said, don't put on my tombstone, he loved God. I said, you put, he loves God. Because the greatest love, even though I have a beautiful wife and love her, wonderful children, brothers and sisters in Christ, and I love you all, I tell you all that many times every single week, and truly I do. I realize the greatest love at all that I've ever had is the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why I do work for him. That's why I do serve him. I'm not a preacher that's going to come and give you a little sermonette every Sunday. I'm going to preach the word of God to you. Because I realized somebody preached the word of God to me one day, And by him preaching the word of God to me, that made me to realize or come to realize I was lost and on my way to hell. And I needed a Savior. And ever since I met this Savior, I'm going to tell you right now, we talked about in Sunday school, there's been troubles, there's been trials, there's been times you thought you was in the fire, but Christ has been there every step of the way. I love him because he first loved me. Now, not only did Jacob come across a woman that he fell madly in love with, her name was Rachel, and he was willing to work 7 years absolutely free just for her hand in marriage, but he done it joyfully. I believe with all my heart God's people need to serve the Lord joyfully. I mean, going to church and coming to church shouldn't be a chore. It shouldn't be something that you dread. It shouldn't be something that you get aggravated over or people aggravate you just to get you here. I'll tell you this, nobody's ever going to have to call and see where Robert Brown is when it's church time, because by God's grace, I'm going to be right here or somewhere in the house of God as far as that goes. Because joyfully, for 39 years, I've enjoyed going to the house of God, and I hope that each and every one of you feel the same. If not, you might need to check, first of all, your salvation, and second of all, you might need to check why you're not happy about being in the house of the Lord. So we realize here, okay, that Jacob did make this agreement with Laban. He did work 7 years. And verse number 21, Bible says, "And Jacob said unto Laban, give me my wife, for my days are fulfilled, that I may go in unto her. And Laban gathered together all the men of the place, and he made a feast. And it came to pass in the evening that he took Leah, his daughter, and brought her to him and went in unto her." Now, y'all caught that, right? Who did he work for? He worked for Rachel. Who did he love? He loved Rachel. But who was it that Laban brought unto Jacob this night? It was not Rachel, but it was his oldest daughter, Leah. The Bible says in verse number 24, "And Laban gave unto his daughter, Leah, Zilpha," if that's how you pronounce it, because I'm not the smartest, "his maid for a handmaiden." So as he gave his daughter, the oldest daughter Leah, unto Jacob that night, he also gave a handmaiden. Her name, as I said, was Zilpha. The Bible says in verse 25, "And it came to pass that in the morning," in other words, it had to be dark, "behold, it was Leah. And he said to Laban," he said, "what is this that thou hast done unto me? Did not I serve with thee for Rachel? Wherefore thou then hast thou beguiled me?" And Laban said, "It must not be so done in our country to give the younger before the firstborn. Fulfill her week," in other words, spend the week with her, "and we will give thee this also for the service which thou hast served with me yet 7 other years. So what we find out here is Jacob deceived his father in trying to trick him that he actually was Esau. And in return here, we find out that Jacob is the one that's gotten deceived as well. The Bible says you'll reap what you sow. The Bible says if you sow to the flesh, you'll reap of the flesh. If you sow to the spirit, you'll reap of the spirit. The only thing that's happening right now is that Jacob got back the same thing that he gave. Sometimes people, and I've had this discussion many times, wonder why they don't have more blessings of God on their life than what they do, or why they're even not more thankful about the blessings of God on their life than they are. Well, sometimes you get what you give. You give very little to God, you get back very little from God. You give greatly to God, and God will open up a window into heaven that even the ocean can't contain. So we find out here in verse number 28, Bible says, "And Jacob did so, and he fulfilled her week, and he gave him Rachel, his daughter, to wife also. And Laban gave to Rachel, his daughter, Bilhah, his handmaid, to be her maid. And he went in also unto Rachel, and he loved also Rachel more than Leah, and served him yet 7 other years. So Jacob did work 7 years for Laban. And what he got in return was the woman that he did not love. But in that he loved Rachel so much, he was willing to tell Laban, "I will work another 7 years just to get that I desire and want." Well, let me say this to you as well this morning, church, okay? I have found out in not only my Christian life, but also in my physical life, that anything worth having is worth working for. If you truly desire it, you truly want it, and you truly deserve it, and it is God's will that you have it, then you should be willing to work for it. I say almost every single week, and not just an old union, I've said it for 37 years now, that if you want the church to grow, you got to be willing to work. If you're not willing to work, then you're never going to get it to grow. The Bible says that Jacob was a man that was willing not only to work for Rachel that he loved, but he also worked for the daughter that he didn't love, but yet at the same time, he was willing to fulfill more years just to get that he truly did desire. Maybe you've got everything in your life that you want right now. There's got to be more. I mean, until this church and every church, as far as I'm concerned, is full to the max, and before the doors are open and chairs are set outside, I'll never be happy about it. Anytime I see an empty pew or somewhere that somebody can be sitting, nobody's sitting there, then I won't be happy about it. Not just because I long to be or am your pastor, as far as that goes, because it's God's will. And I've always said that. It's never been God's will that a church decrease. It's always been God's will that it increase, that the house of God, that the numbers, not necessarily for numbers, but because of growth. The Bible says God would add to the church daily that such be saved. But you got to get them here before you get them saved. You got to invite them. You got to call them. You got to work, the Bible says, for that you love. And if you're not willing to if you're not willing to work, it might be because you just don't love them enough. And that's something we all need to question ourselves every single day. How much do I love the Lord? Jacob loved Rachel enough not only to work 7 years, but to work 14 years. Then the Bible also says this, okay, that Leah began to bear Jacob children. And she bared him 4 sons to begin with. And here we are again, Rachel was not able to bear children. So Rachel became jealous of her sister, Leah. And the Bible says that in that she talked to the Lord and she wanted to be pleasing in the sight of Jacob, because now Jacob had children with Leah, but yet he didn't have no children with her. Of course, thoughts going through her mind, he's not happy with me, and I want him to be happy with me and please me because I love him, he loves me. So what Rachel did is the maid wife or the midwife that God kind of gave her to be her helper. She told Jacob, you go into her. Let her bear children, and I'll be the one to raise it. So Rachel's a midwife, whatever, maiden. I don't know what you call her. But he went into her, and she bare him 2 children. So at this point, he's got 6 children. Well, now Leah, she got word of that as well, and she wasn't happy about that, and she wasn't bearing no more children, so she told Jacob, you go into my handmaid, that's the correct word, you go to my handmaid, so he did, she bare him 2 more children. So if you're keeping count, this is 6 children by Leah and her handmaid, and 2 children by Rachel's handmaid, so 8 children so far. Then as the Lord heard the prayer of Rachel, she began to bear children. And as she bare 2 sons herself, she's at 10, or he's at 10 children. And you'll find out as the story goes on, I know I'm not reading a lot of scripture for sake of time this morning, but as the story goes on, you'll also find out that Leah bare 2 more sons for Jacob. Now, sometimes we don't see the bigger picture of what God's trying to do. And sometimes we may not understand every action that God takes as far as that goes in our lives. But see, God has always and will always have a plan, whether you understand it or whether I understand it or not. But at this point, Jacob has 10 children. And then the Bible says Leah bare him 2 more sons, which if you keep in count now, is 12 sons. These 12 sons became the 12 tribes of the nation Israel. And you and I, we probably would have never figured that out on our own, but when Isaac and Rebecca told Jacob, you need to leave here because your brother's trying to kill you. You need to go to another land, marry another wife. God even had that plan. Sometimes we have to leave the comfort of where we're at just to get the blessings of God, especially when God is doing the leading and God's the one that's trying to direct our paths. But then we go a little bit more into another story. Chapter, if you want to turn with me, over in chapter number 32, I believe it is. Bible says in verse number 24, and I'm trying to wrap everything up. I know we got things going on today. In chapter 32 and verse 24, the Bible says, and Jacob was left alone, and there he wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh, and the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And he said, I will not let thee go, except thou bless me. Now, this particular individual that Jacob was wrestling was not a man at all, but was an angel. And this particular angel could at any time just flip his finger and probably throw Jacob up against a wall somewhere. But he was patient with him. And as Jacob wrestled with him, Jacob said, I want the blessing. And Jacob said, I'm not going to let you go until I'm blessed. Well, let me say this to you as well this morning, church. If you want the blessings of God, you have to hold on. You have to hold on. If you give up, if you quit, if you stop, if you're no longer interested, if you get tired and weary, and the Bible says we do get tired and weary sometimes, you're never going to receive that blessing. What old union might be or can be or we hope to be, okay, some of you may not ever see it because you're quit along the way. Some of you is not willing to hold on to see how this journey ends or how God will bless and has blessed and is going to bless old union for the faithfulness, for the working, for the dedication of each and every individual. But what I do know is this. The Bible says, as Jacob refused to let go of the angel, even though his thigh was out of joint, he still held on because he wanted the blessings of God. Now, as your pastor, let me say this to you. I want the blessings of God on each and every single one of your lives. I want you to have more than you ever had spiritually. I said just a couple weeks ago, I want you to know God is more real in your life now than he's ever been. Now, I want you to know when you call upon God, he's right there listening. If you're saved, if you know the Lord, if you belong to him, God loves you today as much as he ever has. He wants to bless you. In fact, the Bible says he wants to bless you so much that you'd be astonished and amazed at what he can and will and is willing to do. But church, you're going to have to hold on. It's not going to happen overnight. Our attendance has been up, as far as I know, ever since we've been here. I'm thankful for that. The reviews have been up on YouTube every single week. I'm thankful for that. But I don't expect it to happen overnight. But what I do expect is for you and myself as well included to be like Jacob. Find that you love. Be willing to work for it. Is it the youth ministry? Our young people need all the help they can get. Is it these little children you love? Jump in there. Help out. Do all you can to encourage them. Invite others. Some of you teenagers that do you know that you have other friends, they're not in church. You teenagers, you're just as responsible for inviting people as anybody else. If it's your desire and your love to see not only the church grow, but your friends, your family, your neighbors, your relatives to be in church, you've got to work for them. You've got to be willing to invite them. You've got to let them know that God's down here and God's trying to do a work. And you just need to hold on to that you might not be able to see or you might not be able to understand quite at this point. But I assure you this, God is an amazing God. And there is nothing impossible for God. And if you and I, as Jacob, are willing to work for that we truly love and we truly want, and we'll do anything we can by God's grace to achieve it, as long as we just don't let go of that hope and that joy and the promises of God. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, just as Jacob got the blessing, we'll get the blessing as well. The Bible says in verse number 26 once again, he said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And he said, I will not let thee go, except thou bless me. And he said to him, what is thy name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For prince hast thou power, and God with men has prevailed. And Jacob asked him and said, tell me, I pray thee, thy name. And he said, wherefore is it that thou dost ask after my name? And he blessed him there. So Jacob did receive the blessing. He don't know who he was. He didn't ask. I mean, he did ask his name, but the angel didn't give no name. But of course, it was an angel. You can find that out. And the Bible says in verse number 29, when Jacob asked him his name, the Bible says that since he didn't give up, since he held on, that the angel blessed him there. Now, just a couple more facts, and I'm going to close this morning. We also find out this, okay, that the Bible says that Jacob seen God face to face because he had that desire to see God and to be blessed by the hand of God. God not only had done gave Jacob the desires of his life as far as Rachel, but he also made him the king of Israel and named him Israel as well. So that takes us right back to the beginning where the Bible says that God told Rebekah and Isaac that the older would serve the younger. Now Esau and Jacob, they did reunite again on down the road. But the nation, of course, Israel is what Jacob stood for. And the nation of Edom is what his brother Esau stood for. You see, two different brothers. One made wise decisions. The other made foolish. One loved his life and wanted the blessings. The other despised his life and hated everything about it. Sometimes you and I, we may not realize just how good our life is. Some of you might despise your life this morning. You might think your life ain't too good. You might look at your life and you might say, well, this is wrong, that is wrong. I wish this was changed, that was changed. I wish this was different, that was different. It could be because of decisions you've made yourself personally, the reason why your life is the way it is this morning. But I encourage you and tell you this morning as well, God is a God that can change that. And if you're not happy with your life this morning, then God's willing to give you a second chance on making the right decisions as life goes on. If you're here this morning, you've got a desire to have something, if it's God's will, then I believe with all my heart God will give you exactly the desires of your heart, as it says in the book of Psalms, if you're willing to work for it. Now, as we look upon this, and I am closing this morning, this is a very complicated love story. You'll find out that things went kind of haywire more than once. And you'll also find out that Laban deceived Jacob several more times as well before he ever got out of that land. But I encourage you to understand this morning. God is not a God that deceives. God is a God of truth. And everything that God says and writes about in this book is the truth, every single word. And if you're willing to trust God and have your faith in God and live for God, he will give you the blessings that you desire if you're willing to work for him. You want to see his church grow? Go to work. You want to see your family saved? Invite them. Go to work. You want to see the young people in your life or even your children get where they need to be with the Lord? That way they'll make right decisions and not wrong decisions. Invite them to church. Encourage them to come. Tell them that God's trying to do something at Old Union and you want them to be a part of it. Just last week I told these children, I'm not sure who put it on the sign, I guess maybe it's Jeffrey, but I told these children, you can't spell church without you are. It's incomplete. And I told these children, you are important to this church. And that's not just the children this morning, but that's each and every single one of you today. You're important to Old Union Church. And the work that God has for you to do is important as well. Can't nobody fulfill your position except you. And God called you and saved you for one reason, that's to serve him. Trust him. Let him use you for his glory. And just stand back and be amazed at what God can really do. Now let me say this in closing. I ain't going to close but one time this morning today. In closing, even though this was a very complicated love story, And there's many love stories in the Bible. There was one that was made very simple. And that very simple love story is this. God created man, named him Adam, put him in the garden. And he said, Adam, you can do anything you want, just don't eat of that one tree. And of course, what did Adam do? Ate of that one tree. Therefore, Adam began to die that very day. Just like you and I as well, and all men and women will die one day. God already had a plan in store for that as well, how man could live again. And this is how simple it is. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. A lot of us have had very challenging love lives at times. And a lot of us is kind of like Jacob. We've worked hard for a lot of things that we were deceived and didn't get, or they didn't turn out the way we thought. But that's not God this morning, church. God's made it so simple that anybody that's willing to love him, he's always already told us that he loves us. In fact, the Bible says he loves us first. So let me ask you this morning, okay? And I know it's a little bit late, and I'm only going to get Dustin to play just like two verses, if you will, this morning. But I want to ask you, if it's where you can stand and you're able this morning, if you're here and you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior, the love story is just that simple. You come to him, and he'll give you the life that you never would have dreamed of. What about it? Have you made wrong decisions? Are there things you want to change in your life? Then as this altar call is given, and we're only going to play like two verses, won't you come forth this morning?
You say, preacher, I've made some bad decisions.
You might say, preacher, there's things that I want in my life. I just don't know how to get them. Well, if it's God's will, he'll give each and every one of them to you if you're willing to come. So are you here this morning, you don't know the Lord as your Savior? Won't you come today? Listen, I'll be glad to take the time and the Word of God and show you how you can be saved. Would you come this morning? And Christians, let me say this. Are you willing to work? Are you willing to hold on like Jacob? Are you willing to take that great desire that's in your life and put effort forth to achieve it? Or have you lost that desire? Are you not willing to work? Have you not worked lately? Have you given up? Well, this altar is open for you too, friend. If you need to speak to the Lord this morning, he'll be glad to listen. You might even need to tell him, listen, I've lost my joy. The Bible says David lost his joy, but he asked God to give it back, and of course he did. The altar is open this morning. Do you need to come and pray? Anybody, anywhere? If you do, please come. If you want me to pray with you, I'll be more than glad to take the time. Anybody this morning? Right now, in the name of Jesus, and be thy blessed will, thou touch this fire brother.
faith in my vision. It doesn't look promising. I know the Lord will be with me and my wife and my family. And thank y'all so much for praying with us today.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand, Kat.
All right, I'm always encouraged when someone comes to the altar. And of course, that's a very special need this morning, and I know you'll be praying. Is there anything before we dismiss and sing our hymn? Anything?
We can do one thing. We were going to announce it over there, but you're our preacher now.
I already knew that. Thank you.
I need somebody to tell you.
Well, the Lord told me. Let me say this and I'll dismiss. Make that two times. Whether I know your name or not, I love you. Now, I don't say that lightly. And I do believe love is what makes the world go around. Amen. As my wife said this morning, faith, hope, and charity is what the Bible says, or love. And the greatest of all these is love. If we'll love one another and love God, there is no telling what God might do for Old Union Church. I know y'all are willing to work. And I've been in churches, they were not willing to work. And it don't take long to find that out. But I assure you this as well this morning. I will work just as hard, if not harder than anybody else, to see this church grow. And my phone is on 24 hours a day. If I hear it and know it, and I don't get it, I will call you back. And if you need me any time at all, don't never hesitate to call me. And I will be there by God's grace. Thank y'all for opening the doors for me and my wife. This is another plan that we in no way at all ever pictured. But I do believe God's trying to do something. And I thank every one of you. And let's sing a hymn.
Center on page 467. Page 467.
Thank you.
might be embarrassing.